I am holy, therefore you be holy too. And every one of us in Christ are called to live a holy life. Now let me just say this to you. When you look at the standards that God gives to us, and they are incredible standards. You look at the Sermon on the Mount, the things that God calls us to do. He says if you're angry at somebody, you've already murdered them. How about that? The Ten Commandments said, it talked about physical murder. Jesus talks about murdering somebody in your mind. He says, if you look at a woman lustfully, that you've already committed adultery. How does that sit with you, gentlemen? How can we ever live a holy life? Love your enemies and forgive those who persecute you. He even says, do not worry. He equates worry as a sin. We're supposed to be in a place of peace and content. You look at that word, how can I ever live that life? What are you, crazy? But it is through the Holy Spirit of God, when the Holy Spirit, the one who is truly holy, comes and lives in us. And understand, this is the Christian life. Not trying to live up to a bunch of rules. Not trying to keep the Ten Commandments. Not even trying to keep the Sermon on the Mount. It is Christ living in me and through me. And when I surrender myself to Him, those things that Jesus taught become possibilities in my life. That you can truly live an authentic holy life through a surrendered life in Jesus. That is true Christianity. The Christianity that says, all right, do this, do this, do that, don't do this, that's not Christianity. It's a bunch of rules and regulations. That's the law. True Christianity is a surrender to Jesus Christ. He died for me, to live in me, to live through me. And that's how we can truly live a holy life. Paul said this in the book of Galatians chapter 2:20. I have been crucified with Christ, and I no longer live, but the life I live by the faith of the Son of God. By the faith of the Son of God. Even Jesus' faith is living in Paul, and that's how we live this dynamic life. So he is holy. Then I want you to notice he is true. Jesus stood and he said, I am the light of the world. Light is a metaphor for truth. Alethanos, he is the very essence of truth. He is the author of truth, the revealer of truth. He is true in himself. And this is so unique that he says this to this church of Philadelphia. To the church of Philadelphia, he says, I am the truth. I am the true one. And here is this church in a city called Philadelphia that was called the Little Athens. It was called the Little Athens because of all the pagan temples throughout the city. And there were people worshiping Bacchus, and they were worshiping Athena, and they were worshiping Zeus, and they were worshiping Caesar. Think about the time that church was in. And then you had all these other churches, all the other churches that are mentioned in the book of the Revelation. There were seven. Only two of them were not condemned by Jesus. So you got the church of Ephesus that has forsaken their first love, and Pergamos is a church filled with compromise, moral and ethical and doctrinal compromise. Thyatira, they're off the deep end. They're so filled with heresy and false teachers. Sardis is just dead. They've totally denied the faith. And then we'll look at Laodicea in a few weeks, and they're the lukewarm church. And Jesus says, you're lukewarm. You think you're on fire, but you're actually lukewarm. He says, you think you're rich, and you're actually poor. And he goes, you think you're clothed, and you're actually naked. Hey, it reminds me of today. I mean, you know what the one characteristic Jesus said would characterize the end times? You know what it is? Deception. And you know, I don't know if it's that Satan has become more clever. I just think that with the internet and television, there's the ability to deceive people like never before. And I'll tell you, wherever you look, there's deception. There's deception, you have the cults that are outside the church, the heretics outside the church, and then you got the heretics and the false teaching inside the church. And just look at Madison Avenue. Folks, toothpaste is not going to make you rich, sexy, and famous. Preparation H is not going to cause all your problems. And just look at the way they market. They make you think that if you bought that product, I mean, you're going to walk down the street and every girl, every guy is going to be coming running after you. We live in a world of deception. It comes at you from every angle. You know what's beautiful in the midst of that? Again, what the Lord is saying to the church of Philadelphia, I am the true one. I am genuine. There's one who you can know is true. It's not religion. It's Jesus. And Jesus eclipses all the false teachers. Jesus totally, he just wipes out the false teachers when we look at him and the false doctrines and the heresies. Listen, I've taught you guys who study with me on Wednesday nights as we went through the book of Genesis last year. The first verse in the book of Genesis, and here, the comparative verse in the New Testament. Jesus said, and it says of him in John chapter 1, verse 1, in the beginning was the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was with God in the beginning. In Genesis 1:1, it says this. And here's the Word. Remember? Jesus is the Word. So it says, in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. I just want to show you what that does. Somebody who came from atheism, somebody who was a materialist, okay? I want to just tell you what that one verse does. Listen to this. What Jesus does, it refutes atheism because the universe was created. It refutes pantheism because God is transcendent to that which he created. It refutes polytheism, for one God created all things. It refutes materialism, for matter had a beginning. It refutes dualism because God was alone when he created. It refutes humanism because God, not man, is the ultimate reality. And it refutes evolutionism because God created all things. In one verse, by the way, the seven philosophies or isms that I just mentioned to you, you will find every false religion, you will find every false philosophy, you will find every cult in those seven things, and in one verse, Jesus, okay, totally dispels them. He is the truth. And in a world that calls white-black, and black-white, and good-bad, and bad-good, in a world that calls true-false and false-true, and calls up-down and down-up, there is one who we can truly rely upon as being the truth, and that is Jesus Christ. He who has the keys of David. He is holy, he is true, and he has the keys of David. And he who opens, no one shuts, and he who shuts, no one opens. Now, that is a reference, those of you taking notes, to Isaiah chapter 22:22 of a man named Eliakim, who was a true man of God in a time where the prophets were all liars and deceivers and looking after their own personal gain. There is this man Eliakim in Isaiah chapter 22, and this is what it says of Eliakim. It tells us that essentially Eliakim and the key of the house of David will be laid upon his shoulder. So he shall open and no one shall shut, and he shall shut and no one shall open. Eliakim was given the keys. Jesus has the keys. The keys of David whenever David is mentioned in reference to Jesus, it talks about the messianic kingdom. Jesus is the Messiah. He now is the root of David. And he has the keys to open. To open what? To open salvation. To open up the blessings of God. To pour them out in our lives. When I was coaching my son, who was in sixth grade, I had two guys who were coaching with me. And one was a CEO of a big company in New York, and the other was a president of a Fortune 500 company. And here were the three of us working with a sixth grade team, and what a team we had. I think that year we lost one game. So we went to the school to do a practice, and when we went to the closet, none of us had a key to open the door. And this is the way it looked. Here we were, three important men, and we came to open the door, but we were impotent. Do you understand? Impotent, not important. We were important, but when it came to opening the door, we were impotent. We had intensity. When it came to open the door, we were inadequate. We had intellectualism, but when it came to opening the door, we were inept. We were men of insistence, but when it came to opening the door, we were incapacitated. We were men of innovation, but when it came to opening the door, we were incomplete. We were men of intelligence, but when we were trying to open the door, hey folks, it was insanity. Although we, I guess in our egos, we thought of ourselves that we were very influential in our little piddly experiences and achievements in our human existence, we were totally insignificant and inferior when it came to opening that door. We stood there and we looked and, hey, we were very frustrated. We couldn't get the door open. And in our despair, we decided that we needed an intercessor. And suddenly we looked, and walking down the hallway was our intercessor. And the intercessor, he had hanging from his hip a keychain which looked like it had an innumerable number of almost an infinite amount of keys. And in his innocence, he took one key and he put it in the door and he turned the key. It was infallible. It was invincible. And suddenly the door opened and the three of us were intoxicated with his ingenuity. We were invigorated by his influence. He was the janitor. And the three of us were, again, totally immobilized, but he had the keys. And Jesus has the keys. And I don't care how influential you are, you will not be able to open the door. I don't care how intelligent you are, you will not be able to open the door. I don't care how much intensity you have, you will not be able to open the door. Jesus has the keys, and only he can open the door. And that door is the door to his salvation, and that is the door to heaven. For I am the way, the truth, and the life, he said, and no one can come to the Father except through me. So he is true, and he is holy, and he holds the keys of eternal life and eternal blessing. Now, I want you to notice, what he opens, no one can shut, and what he shuts, no one can open. The devil can't stop him. The skeptics can't stop him. The God-haters can't stop him. They're not going to be able to close what he's open, and they're not going to be able to open what he's closed. Then I want you to notice in verse 8, the commendation. He says, I know your works. Here was a church that had they had good works. Do you realize that as believers, we're not going to be judged? We're not judged according to our works as far as salvation goes. We're saved by grace through faith. But we will be judged according to our works, and there is going to be an award ceremony in the future. It's called the Bema Seat of Christ, where every believer is going to stand before Jesus, and he is going to either give you awards or no awards for what you've done as a Christian while in this body. He's given you talents. Remember, he gave 1-5, 1-2, and 1-1? And there is going to be an award ceremony, and God is going to judge you as to what you did while you were in this body as far as serving him, working for him. Remember the story of the woman? She dies and she goes to heaven. She's a believer. She trusted in Jesus. She meets Peter at the pearly gate. They begin to walk along the street of gold. She says, I want to see my mansion. Peter, as they walk along, she says, is that my mansion? Peter says, no, that's Moses' mansion. They're walking along. Is that my mansion? No, that's Paul's mansion. Is that my mansion? No, it's Timothy's. Is that my mansion? No, that's Jonah. And they go all the way to the end of the street. And there's this little shack there. And Peter says, there's your mansion. And she says, that's my mansion for an eternity? And Peter looked at her and he said, that's all we could do with what you sent us. By the way, that's true. You can be saved, listen, you can be saved today like that by grace, by just putting your faith in Jesus Christ. But it's the awards and the rewards that you're going to have through an eternity, they will be dependent upon what you've done in this body. Or have you served him? Have you been faithful in praying to him? Have you been a faithful witness to him? Have you been faithful in giving to him? Look, the Lord is omniscient. He says here, I know your works. He knows everything about you. He knows how you spent your week. He knows the time that you waste when you can be using that time for the building of the kingdom of God. He knows that. You're not going to fool him. You may fool yourself. You may fool others. You can't fool Christ. Here's a church that was truly faithful in their works. Truly faithful in their works. Let me just say this. God comes to me. He came around here years ago. Folks, he'd come late, he'd leave early, he was always moody, always complaining, and he always was a problem. And he calls me up and he wants to be a worship leader. I just want to say, it was like a worship leader. I was nice to him. I didn't, but what's going on in my mind is, a worship leader? A worship leader? Is this guy serious? You want to be a worship leader in this church that I pastor? And, wait, I said to him, no, we have worship leaders. But as I put down the phone, I happened to get in the car and I was driving, I'm thinking of Lenny. Lenny is our worship leader. You know, I'm just thinking, this guy, he drove me crazy. He drove me nutty. He's moody, he's inconsistent, he's unreliable. And I just think, I got Lenny. When you got Lenny, man, you just, let me tell you, besides Lenny being gifted, this guy is a rock. I'm going to tell you, I preached the sermon and I've seen the sermon not, you know, before my eyes. This guy's a rock. He's consistent. He's always on time. In fact, he's early all the time. He does whatever it takes. He's reliable. He's a person who is going to be rewarded greatly, and I believe far more than I am when he gets to heaven, when we get to heaven. He's got good works. Now notice this. Five things. I have set before you an open door and no one can shut it. And it's talking about evangelism. Again, here's a church that, again, is gathering and studying the scriptures. They're gathering and worshiping God. And then they're scattering and they're proclaiming the gospel to the world. It's a church that was evangelistic. They're leading people to Christ and people's lives are being transformed. For you have little strength. Notice what that's saying. The word there for strength is dunamis. When the man who invented dynamite wanted a word for dynamite, he went to a Christian theologian and said, what's the most powerful word in the Bible? And he gave him the word dunamis, and he called dynamite, dynamite. Let me tell you something. The power of God is dynamite. The power of God, when it came bursting into my life, let me tell you, it exploded my atheism. It exploded my skepticism. It exploded my materialism. It is incredibly powerful. It's radical. It's explosive. And here's this little church. And it's a little church. It's not large. They probably don't have a lot of numbers. Kind of poor. Little flock. Average folks. No CEOs. No presidents of corporations. There's no NFL quarterbacks. No home run hitters. No congressmen. No movie stars. What you got in this little church, though, is a bunch of simple people, like Paul said to the Corinthians. Not many of you were wise, not many of you were noble, not many of you were spectacular in this world, but God takes the simple things, the little things, to shame the world. And here's this little church, kind of unknown, you know, just in this little nook, this little corner of the world. So he takes these simple folks who are operating in the power of God, and he uses them to transform the world. When the apostles in Acts chapter 4 appeared before the religious leaders of Israel, they said, these men are uneducated. They were uneducated, but they were turning the world upside down. What does God use? You know what the Lord uses? Look at this. Two types of people that you see throughout the scriptures. Shepherds. Who's the other group that he uses? Stinky fishermen. In fact, they both were pretty stinky. You know what God does? He says that I'm going to accomplish my purpose, whether it's by crook or hook. He takes simple people who have the power of God to transform the world. You know what it reminds me of? I used to have a training partner. His name was Mike. Mike was this little Armenian guy. I was a big bodybuilder, powerlifter. I was running about 260, 270. Mike was probably down around 220. Mike squatted 840 pounds. Mike bench pressed 550. Mike deadlifted over 700 pounds. Mike, one of the best lifters in the world. He still has the third best squat in his weight class. He was kind of small, but let me tell you, he was powerful. The church in Philadelphia was small, but it was incredibly powerful. And it says that they have kept my word. There was a church, obviously, that was in the word. You've got to be in the word to keep the word. If you're not reading the word, and you're not learning the word, and you're not hearing the word, obviously you can't keep it. But here was a church that obviously was in the word, and they were not just simply in the word, they were doing the word. Two problems that people have in church. One is, they're not in the word. If you're not in the word, you're in trouble. I think it's just a matter of time before you just fall away, if you're not in the word. You're going to fall by the way. You're going to be gone. Go back in, to the world. And if you're not in the Word, I'll tell you, if you are in the Word, The second problem that occurs is, are you obeying the word? If you're not obeying the word, you know what you have? You have a heart problem. People don't know, Christians who don't obey the word have a heart problem. You know, Jesus said, John chapter 14, he said it four times. If you love me, you'll obey me. If you're not obeying me, it's because you don't love me. He said it four times, four different ways. For those who love me will always obey me. If you're having a problem obeying God, you got a heart problem. You know, a simple song that we sing here to help you to fix that. Lead me to Calvary. Lest I forget Gethsemane. Lest I forget thine agony. Lest I forget thy love for me, lead me to Calvary. You've got a problem obeying the Lord? You need to go to the cross of Christ, and you need to see his hands that were pierced for you, and his feet that were pierced for you, and you need to see him hanging on that cross, dying in your place, and you need to fall in love with him. In the Gospel of John, chapter 15, verses 12 through 15, Jesus said this, "This is my commandment, that you love one another as I have loved you. Greater love has no one than this, that he laid down his life for his friends." And he says, "You are my friends if you are doing what I command you." You know what the church of Philadelphia was? A church that was in friendship with Jesus. Like Lazarus, Martha, and Mary. You know, do you know him? Do you know him? Do you know him as your God? Do you know him as the Lord of your life? The Lord of your mind, and the Lord of your body, the Lord of your sex organs, and the Lord of your pocketbook, and the Lord of your home, and the Lord of your family, and the Lord of your marriage, and the Lord of your children, and the Lord of your career. Do you know him as the Lord? And do you know him as the Savior? The one who died for you on the cross, who saves you from all your sins. Do you know him as your best friend? This church knew him that way, and they knew him as their best friend. Notice the fourth thing. "And have not denied my name." They were loyal. They were hanging on. They weren't quitting. They weren't flaky. They weren't flighty. To deny the name of the Lord is to deny him as your Savior, to deny him as your God, to deny him as the Lord, to deny him as the Messiah. Sue and I got saved a number of years ago. And I was teaching everybody the word. I didn't know how to teach the word. I was more zealous than smart. That's a dangerous place to be. But I was teaching, I was doing Bible studies on the racquetball courts in the health club that I was part owner in. I was doing Bible studies in people's homes. I take them through a workout. You have to strap them to the machines. Once I had them on those machines, baby, they're going to hear the gospel. And they give me any mouth. You know when people give you a little mouth when you're sharing the gospel with them, man? Man, I push them until they puke, you know? I mean, you're going to just do that. So my wife and I, we start this Bible study in Old Japan. And there's a family that's hosting it. They go to a church nearby here. And he's a very wealthy guy. And he's Jewish. And he says he's a believer. But we start talking about Jesus being God. Jesus is not God. Jesus is the Messiah. Jesus is the Christ. Jesus is the Savior. He's not God. And we would knock heads with this. Say, Jesus is God. Look, in him was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. Jesus called himself the great I am. He said, "For you seeing me, I seen the Father, for I'm the Father of one." He's called the Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace, in the book of Isaiah chapter 9. We go through all the verses with him. And he's not God, he's not God. So one day, they're getting really frustrated with me teaching this study, so they call their pastor, and their pastor comes, and he's pastoring this tiny little church. And he comes in, and I sat there, and I knew he was a Christian pastor, and I said to him, "Pastor," I said, "tell Mike that the scriptures teach that Jesus is God." Now, Mike is the number one supporter in his church, probably giving about 90% of the money. You should have seen this pastor. He backed down. I couldn't believe it. He was more concerned about Mike giving his tithe to his church than telling Mike that Jesus is God and leading him into a true, genuine relationship with Christ. He backed down. He backed down like a sissy who saw a grizzly bear. I'm telling you, he backed down. He backed down. You know how bad he backed down? It was like when the lion is running after, right, the zebra. That's how he backed down. Lord, please give me another one. I'm in trouble here, Lord. Give me another one. He just backed down. I when he did that, you know what I said? I'll never do that. I will never. Got a nice letter from Janice McGarity. They were former members of our church, moved down to South Jersey. She was here with us last week. They've been looking for a church for quite a while since they've left here. And she said, we can't find a church where the pastor preaches the truth. It seems they just tell people what they want to hear. That day was a major turn. I promise you, I will teach you the word of God. And you can leave. You can get offended. You can hate me. I'm going to teach you the word of God. It's so black and white here. Here is a church that, hey, they did not deny the name of the Lord and they were being persecuted. And notice verse 9, indeed I will make those of the synagogue of Satan who say they are Jews and are not, but lie indeed, I will make them come and worship before your feet to know that I have loved you. Just simply hear what the word is saying. These were not Jewish people. Again, I taught this to you before. They were people who were against Gentiles, who were converted to Judaism, and they were persecuting the Christians. And it's always the religious who will always persecute the Christians. And yet, again, they didn't deny the Lord. And it's really neat. It says they will come and worship at your feet. And that's a theme you see in the Old Testament. God saying to his people that those who persecuted one day are going to come and worship me, and they're going to be at your feet. They're going to humble themselves. You ever watch the Narnia Chronicles or read the Narnia Chronicles? Right? Understand the Narnia Chronicles. Aslan is Jesus. The White Witch is the devil. Peter, Susan, Edmund, and Lucy are the sons of Adam, the sons of Eve, or the daughters of Eve. And you remember, you ever notice in that, when sometimes in those episodes, the animals would come and bow down? That's where C.S. Lewis got it from. The people who are enemies one day, we're going to see them on their knees, and they're bowing before the Lord, but we're kings, we're his priests. And a glorious thing to see. Fifth thing I want you to notice, verse 10, because you have kept my command to persevere. Again, they endured, they didn't deny. And then notice what the Lord says in verse 10. This is very important. Because you have kept my command to persevere, I also will keep you from the hour of trial which shall come upon the whole world to test those who dwell on the earth. This is very, very, very important. And I need you to put your thinking caps on here and think for a moment. This is a wonderful promise that we have. I want you to notice it says, I will keep you. The word for keep is teria. Very, very important is teria. It means to keep, it means to guard. There is a preposition in the Greek that's attached to it, and the preposition is ek, and it means out of. So I just want you to put the words together. I will keep you out of. Okay? I will keep you out of. I used to believe, early in my Christian walk, that the church would go through the tribulation. I don't believe that anymore. Tribulation is a 7-year period that is described from Revelation chapter 6 through 19. All I can tell you is, it's not as bad as hell. But let me tell you, you don't want to be there. We're going to go through that and all those passages in these upcoming months. But the promise here for the church of Philadelphia is, I will keep you out of it. Now, I just want to stress something to you, because I know that occasionally we get people in the church who say, oh, no, the church is going to go through the tribulation. Let me just stress this to you. The word for through is dia, and it is nowhere to be found in this passage. Okay? Terio ek, I will keep you out. Because I believe we are very close to that time right now. The signs that Jesus gave us, the signs that the prophet gave us, are being fulfilled in this world like never before. We are living in that time. I believe we are right at the door. So it is a wonderful promise for true believers that we will not go through that time. He says here that he will keep you from the hour of trial. People say, well, geez, it's only an hour. Just remember, a day is like 1,000 years, and 1,000 years is like a day to God. It's not talking about a literal 60 minutes. It's talking about a period. And I think, again, the book of the Revelation makes that very clear. It's a 7-year period. He said it's going to come upon the whole world. It is spoken in the future. It will come upon the entire world. It's going to come upon every continent. It's going to come upon every ocean. It's going to come upon every lake, upon every stream. That's exactly what the Revelation says. And it will come upon every person. Every person. who is left here is going to experience what is called this tribulation. Now, notice what the scripture says. It is to test those who dwell on the earth. To test those who dwell upon the earth. I want to share, again, something of importance here with this. Who are those who dwell on the earth in this passage? So if you say, oh, it's going to come upon all those who dwell on the earth, so it's the church. And I want you to just, you know, use your Bibles here with me. Here, let me just say this to you. If you don't come to our church, I want to stress something. If you're from another area, you're visiting us today, find a church. And listen to this. Find a church with a pastor. He preaches the Word of God. Let me just stress this. He preaches the Word from its historical context. Because if you take the Word of God out of its historical context, you can make it mean whatever you want. And that's what cults and heretics do. By the way, that's what a lot of TV evangelists do. And they manipulate people and get people to give them all kinds of money by using all kinds of passages that have nothing to do, okay, have nothing to do with their claiming they have to do with. You have to take the passage from its historical context. The second thing is, you've got to look at the word meanings and the grammar, something I just did, okay, Terry O'Hack. And then the third thing you have to do, you have to interpret Scripture with Scripture. I listen to a lot of preachers. You know what? People give me CDs. Oh, you gotta listen to this preacher. I get sick of hearing preachers telling me their opinions. I don't want to hear your opinions. I want to hear the Word of God. Don't tell me what you think the passage means. Show me from the Scriptures what it means. Because Scripture interprets Scripture. Now listen to this. In Revelation 3:10, it says, because you have kept my command to persevere, I also will keep you from the hour of trial, which is to come upon the whole world to test those who dwell on the earth. Who are those who dwell on the earth? Now, flip with me with your Bible. I'm going to do this real quick. Revelation chapter 6, verse 10 through 11. These are people who have been martyred during the tribulation. What do they say? And they cried with a loud voice, saying, how long, O Lord, holy and true, until you judge and avenge our blood? They have been martyred for their faith during the tribulation. And it says that you would avenge our blood on who? Those who dwell on the earth. Obviously, those who dwell on the earth are not believers. Revelation chapter 8, 13. And I looked and heard an angel flying through the midst of heaven, saying with a loud voice, whoa, whoa, whoa. By the way, that's curse, curse, curse to the inhabitants of the earth. Obviously, the Lord is not going to curse true believers because of the remaining blasts of the trumpet of the three angels who are about to sound. That's speaking about those who are non-believers. Revelation chapter 11, verse 7 through 10. Talking about the two witnesses. When they finish their testimony, the beast that ascends out of the bottomless pit, that is the Antichrist, will make war against them, overcome them, and kill them. And their dead bodies will lie in the street of the great city, which is spiritually called Sodom of Egypt, where also our Lord was crucified, obviously Jerusalem. Then those from the peoples, tribes, tongues, and nations will see their dead bodies. Notice this, CNN. Do you notice that? The whole world will look at one event happening in one time. That was back in the first century. How did John know that? They will be looking upon the dead bodies. And those from